So, the picture that you see, you probably, some of you said you've seen it before. Do you remember where and when? Have I showed it in
church?
Children's
I saw once in church, I think like 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks
that
ago.
That recently?
Mm-hmm. Maybe it was longer than that.
Anyway, I have this picture on my wall over there. And I take it off the wall when I'm preparing families like yours for the day you were baptized. Because it shows Jesus putting down a foundation. And do you know how old you were when you were baptized?
Young.
Oh, God.
4 months?
2 months.
Any
idea?
I think April. So a month.
A month?
Or a year, I don't know.
Okay.
My dad and I were born. My dad and I were baptized on the same day.
I remember that. So anyway, none of us remember. And none of us were capable of saying to Jesus, I'd like you in my life. So your parents did that for you. Your parents said, Jesus, please put down a solid foundation in the life of my child. And you're proof that he did that. Because you're here. So I put the picture back up on the wall. And now I take it down again at as it were. It's on the wall. It's on the screen. And you'll notice that Jesus isn't just building the foundation, right? What do you notice? Behind him.
Well, there's already cement, bricks.
There's bricks, so he's thinking about building what? A house?
Okay. Maybe a building.
Okay. So this is where you, one of the things that Confirmation Sunday is where you say to Jesus, in a formal way, I'd like you to stay on the job. And Jesus says, I'm on it. So I will put the picture back up on the wall. And then I will take it down again when adult members come to Mount Cross to join. And I've asked this question for as long as I've had that picture, which is about 35 years, I think. I ask, is anybody a finished house? And nobody's ever said yes. I can't say nobody. I was in this room 11 years ago, and one eighth grader said, yeah! Well, we won't even divulge who that was, but we know none of us are finished. God is always working on us.
But we die.
Till, maybe not even then, but yes. Yeah. Who knows? Who's to say what happens in heaven as far as growth and change? But anyway, we continue. Sometimes God has to do some demolition to take stuff down that doesn't belong and remodel and replace and so on. We're always under construction. So I want to give you a little history lesson on the place that you're calling your church home at the moment with a quick run through of some of the pastors who've been here. Pastor Bagleen is the one who got us started back in the 60s. He knocked on doors all over town to say, hey, we're starting a new church. Why don't you come on down? Pastor Hansen followed him 5 years later. Pastor Nassen 5 years after that. It was the 70s, what can I say? Pastor Miley was the senior pastor before I came. Along the way, he had some help, part-time helpers for different things. I don't have pictures of two of the guys that were here between Pastor Miley when he left and when I came. But then there's me. I came in 91. Pastor Eric, as we remember, and Pastor Elizabeth, so that's our faces. That is a picture of the first worship service that Mount Cross ever had. It was in a movie theater. Yeah, it was pretty cool. So they all turned around and looked up at the projection booth where the cameraman was.
Was that on Palm Sunday, or was that just decorations?
This was December, so I don't know why they had palms, to tell you the truth. That's an interesting
question.
Way
they when you think December, who doesn't think of summer?
Yeah, well, in California, palms all year round, right?
Australia, it's California.
So then the next year, they were still meeting in the movie theater. They had the signing of the charter, which is what officially gave birth to our church. So that's our anniversary day.
It wasn't the movie theater God Club anymore.
Not the movie theater God Club anymore. So they bought this property that we're on today and broke ground for this building that we're in right now and put up the cross. I don't know if you know, but that cross was poured on the ground. They put wooden forms up and filled it up with concrete. When it hardened, then they lifted the whole thing up. Remember that, because we'll come back to it in a minute. That's this church. That's this building.
Whoa.
About where the pretty much everything in the outer office was added on. So about where that wall is, that next to Sherry's desk is the outside wall. This was the narthex, this area here. And this wall had a door in it, and you went into the sanctuary, which looked like that. So that's where the preschool is now. Okay? Looking in that direction.
Whoa.
So that cross on the wooden wall is where that craft room is at the very end of the big building. And that wonderful wooden ceiling has been covered up with the fake ceiling. Because when they moved the preschool in, that was way too noisy. So they lasted in that building for a while, but in the 1980s, a lot of people started coming to Mount Cross from another church, and it got too crowded, so they had groundbreaking for the church that we have now. You notice in the background on the ground, you see what's there?
Sidewalk.
It looks like a sidewalk. That's actually the outline of the cross they poured all those years before, and the grass never grew back. So that was the outline of that cross on the ground all the years until the church was built, and then it disappeared.
Huh.
I thought that's, but they used to have Easter sunrise service out there. So that's what it looked like where they were constructing it.
Yeah.
About the same time, the preschool came. How many of you went to preschool here?
I did.
Oh, that's pretty impressive.
Do you know the blue house on Centers, or not Centers, on Las Rosas? It's like the blue house.
The blue house.
It's like the Lutheran church.
Oh, yeah.
Over there. That's
okay.
Where I went to preschool.
Oh, yeah, okay. So,
up in the Heights,
Pastor Work, Pastor Eric came and started the contemporary service way back in the day. It was Matt Johnson.
No.
There's Meredith in the middle.
Oh, my.
From a few years ago.
Oh, my.
When we used to send groups of adults and children, youth group, down to Mexico to build houses in Tijuana. You probably don't even know what Project Peace was. Do you know what Project Peace was?
Mm-hmm.
Quick story. This is one of the most proud moments I've had at Mount Cross my whole time here. You heard of Hurricane Katrina.
Oh, yeah.
Wiped out New Orleans and stuff. Well, after that, my wife and I decided we would send a couple $100 down there to help pastors that lost their homes. But before we sent it, I cashed it into $5 bills. And for the children's sermon in November of 2005, just a couple months after this, and I don't know if you guys weren't here then.
I was in Chicago.
For the children's sermon, I gave every one of the kids that came up a $5 bill. I gave away $100 that morning, and I said to the kids, you can keep it, I won't be mad. You can give it back in a month, or, this was the Sunday where we heard the parable of the talents, where Jesus told a story about a guy who gave one guy 10, one guy 5, one guy 2, and the guy with the 2 buried him in the ground, didn't do anything with him, but the one with the 5 and the one with the 10 doubled their money and gave it back to the master, and Jesus praised him for that. So I thought, okay, see what you can do with it. I gave away $100. I got back $1,800 from the kids a month later. They did all kinds of things. I haven't got time to tell you, but it was so impressive.
How?
Well, for example, some of the kids used the money to help pay for an ad for a yard sale, and they sold toys and games that they didn't want anymore, made money. Other kids made dog biscuits and sold them on the patio, all wrapped up in red cellophane. Two brothers bought envelopes and stamps and wrote letters to their family and friends, said, this is what we're doing at our church, send us money. And we got all this money back that we could send. Instead of $200, we sent almost $2,000.
How old are the kids?
The kids that come up for children's sermons. So from what, 2 to 5th grade? Very creative. I can't say their parents didn't help them, but still. So come the next year, when we were getting ready to celebrate our 40th anniversary, long story short, we decided to help a church in New Orleans area, Peace Lutheran Church in Slidell, which is across the lake. And I gave away $100 bills to the adults that would take them. This was not my money this time, it was the church's money. And the deal was you could give it back at the end of the project or see if you could do what the kids did. I gave away $3,500 and we brought back in about $42,000 and sent it to that church to help them build something special. So that's their pastor, Barb, who came to Mount Cross, and we gave her one of those big old checks, you know, that they give like at the golf tournaments and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And plus the real check. But anyway, that was pretty cool.
Oh, God.
So, I use the infinity sign to talk about who we are as God's people here a lot. Because you go out into the world every week, but you come back to the center where we worship and pray and learn, and then you go back out, and then you come back in, and you go back out. And some of you might say, well, that's boring. It's the same thing every time. Except you're not the same person when you go out, and you're not the same person when you come back. Every time you go in and out, it's a different world, and you're a different person. So we are, of course, a Christian church. I think everybody knows that, based on the death and resurrection of Jesus. There's that. And we are, this is more about your baptism, is where you were rescued. We already talked about that. And Jesus now is a personal Lord of yours. We are also a Lutheran church, which doesn't mean we worship Luther, but we follow some of the things that he has taught us. What was it? We agree with many, but not all. We don't have time to talk about all of that. But this is a big year for the Lutheran Church, as you may know, because in October it will be 500 years since the event of nailing the 95 Theses. Have you read about that in history class? The Reformation?
Yeah. Last year.
I'll say one thing that we've learned about God's Word from Luther that is remains very important for us. And to illustrate, I'll use a Woody Allen movie that you've probably never seen. Nobody has ever seen this movie. I think I'm the only one in the world that's seen this movie because I ask every time I do this thing. Woody Allen made this movie called The Purple Rose of Cairo. And it's about this woman, played by Mia Farrow, who is in like 1930s New York City. Depression. It's a bad time. And her husband is an a-hole. Beats her. Takes the money that she earns so he can buy cigarettes, buy liquor, and gamble with it, and just treats her like dirt. So she works in a little diner during the week, but every chance she gets, she goes to the movie theater to watch whatever to escape her awful life. And of course, they play the same film. It's a oneplex. They play the same film all week long, and she goes as often as she can to see the same movie over and over. So she's probably watching this movie called The Purple Rose of Cairo for the second or the third time. It's an adventure movie in Egypt. They're trying to find, like, King Tut's tomb, one of those kind of movies. And while she's watching the movie, all of a sudden, one of the characters in the film steps off the screen into the theater. It's like, what? And when I saw that, I saw an example of what Martin Luther told us happens when we read the Word of God. It's not just words on a page. But when you encounter this word, it's like Jesus steps out of the book and says, I'm going to eternity, do you want to come? That's the right answer. Okay? When we hear a living word, that's what God is meeting you as a live person through this writing. So I won't spoil the rest of the movie for you. If you don't want to see it sometime. But off they go having their adventures. So that's how we don't just hear the word of God or read the word of God. Meet God in the Word. We're part of something bigger, the ELCA. You've probably heard those letters. It's one of about 40 different Lutheran flavors in this country, large and small. Anyway, we won't spend a lot of time. That's approximately one dot per church. So you can see that.
Is it Lawton, Minnesota?
Yeah, the first wave of Lutherans came to this country and landed in what's the colonial part, so New Jersey, Pennsylvania, over that way, Virginia. And the next wave came in the 1800s into the 1900s, the upper Midwest, and from there they've gone other places. There's a lot of dots in places like Southern California and Northern California, and Texas, even in Florida, because during the war, a lot of men and women who had to go to San Diego to ship out said, I'm not going back to North Dakota winters, and they stayed. So anyway, there is, so I'm the pastor of this church. Bishop Irwin is kind of like the pastor of all the churches in our part of Southern California, and Pastor Eaton is the pastor for the whole ELCA.
I saw him.
Yeah, where was he?
In a documentary.
No.
On
he came.
He's probably been to one of the youth.
Well, I've seen him. I've seen him before.
Yeah,
but I saw him in a documentary that I watched in seventh grade.
Really?
I'm like, hey, I think I saw him. It was like, he was like, had to do with Cal Lutheran. What was he?
Okay. He used to teach at Cal Lutheran.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, he's a brilliant man. And she is brilliant too. I've never met her yet. But so, I don't know if you've ever seen this word liturgy. Heard it? Mm-hmm. Have any idea what it means? That's what most people are with most people. A lot of people think liturgy means that's what we do in church, the same every week. You can do it by heart. You don't have to think about it. You can kind of go to sleep while you do it. It's sort of dead, you know, boring and so on. What it really means is the work of the people. So in worship, if you're sitting there like you're watching a movie and I'm the movie, I'll take responsibility for screwing up because it's supposed to be all of our work. Praising God, thanking God, confessing to God is the work that we all do together. So in that regard, I like using the illustration of an art museum as the worst case scenario for what the church might be. Worst case, I'm the curator of the museum. And on Sundays, I open up the museum, and y'all come in and look at the stuff, and then y'all go home, and I lock up the museum. It wasn't that nice. Anybody ever been to a museum? Ever feel like your life was changed because you went to the museum? Not so much. I would rather the church be more like this. Ever been to Home Depot? Now, you're probably not the same crowd that I'm usually talking to. Okay. But you're not there just looking at the stuff, usually. You're there because, and this will be more true the older you get, especially when you get your own home, you're there because you need materials to build something with, you need to buy the tools to build it with, or you've screwed it up so bad you got to find the guys with the orange vest and say, help me do this. Okay? That's what we got going on here at church. You are all working on projects. Not with wooden nails, but your lives. You're working on your education right now, on the way to your career. You've got friendships right now. Those are projects that require work to keep them where they belong. And down the road, careers and who knows, families and so on, all of those are projects. And you come here not to build your projects. You don't come here to be a Christian. It's easy to be a Christian at church. It's hard to be a Christian in the world. So you're here to get prepared each week to get sent back out, sent back out, sent back out. So we changed the name of our church to Faith Depot. I wouldn't be upset. We are a corporation. We are a California 501c3 nonprofit corporation, and the laws, we have charter and all that stuff, but we have to be a legal corporation. But we're also a corporation in the sense that we are the body of Christ. We are members one of another. And I don't know if you've heard this word stewardship, but it has a lot of meanings. But for me, what it mostly means is saying thank you to God. So let's talk about gift giving for a minute. There's the moment of a gift given and received. So far, so good. Then what happens next? You open it, right? Then what happens next? You use it the way it was intended to be used. Mm-hmm. You don't use your Father's Day tie, Dad's, to shine your shoes. Okay? You wear it with pride. So after gifts have been given and received and opened and used, there's one more thing.
Say thank you.
Say thank you. Okay? So we believe that in that rescue from you, of you from the bottom of that pool, I think it was 2 years ago, one of the kids, I forget who it is now, who was standing with me around the font said, that happened to me. She was in the bottom of the pool and was rescued. I wish I could remember who it was. So if that was you, literally in the pool, that was rescued, when you saw who rescued you, what would you say to them?
Thank you.
Thank you. You saved my life. You gave me my life back. Well, in baptism, that's what God has done. Is God's given you your life back, so we say thank you every way you can think of. So what I'd like you to do for the rest of your life is continue to discover why you need to give thanks. And I have this map of where Jesus lived, because I find it interesting that, as you probably know, there's two major bodies of water in what we call the Holy Land. You've heard of the Sea of Galilee, I trust. Mm-hmm. And the bigger one down below is called the Dead Sea. Now, the Sea of Galilee is fed from the north. The headwaters are up somewhere, maybe towards Lebanon, I don't know. The water flows down the Jordan River into the Sea of Galilee, flows back out. And the Sea of Galilee is full of fish. There must have been a dozen or more fishing villages at the time of Jesus. It's a beautiful place. The water flows down the Jordan River into the Dead Sea, and there's no outlet. Dead Sea receives but doesn't give. And so all the minerals and the salts that flow down the Jordan River don't have anywhere to go, so it gets saltier and saltier and saltier. And ask somebody who's been there, who's actually gone into the water, you almost float on top of the water, it's so salty. It's a physics lesson, you might say. And it's dead, there's nothing that lives in there. So the point being, if you want to be alive, you receive from God and you give away. If you want to be dead, just receive but not give anything away. So, we say thanks by giving our best and what we call first fruits. So in the Bible, when they collected a harvest, they gave the first part back to God as a way of saying thanks. So that's what I will encourage you to do as you continue to mature. Giving our money is part of the way we support this corporation, this church of ours. If any of you want to have offering envelopes, let me know. Pretty much, we don't usually give them out on the younger side. But when it comes time for you to start turning in a tax return, where you want to be able to tell the IRS, yes, I gave this much money to the church, I can deduct that from my taxes, you're going to want to have a box of envelopes so we can give you a report that you can use. But hopefully you'll find over the years ways that you want to give back, which you already are doing. I mean, how many of you are working on Saturday at the dinner? All of you, I hope. Saturday night, make big celebrate. That's part of the way that you're earning money for a winter, a summer trip. So, but you've already been given lots of different ways. So we're going to talk more about that when we get to the packet. So we don't live together. It's not a commune here, but we do live the faith together here somewhat, so that's how we do that. What does it mean to be a disciple of Jesus? Well, there are some, like the Amish, who believe they're following Jesus by turning away from the world. They believe the world's going to kind of stain their faith, because the world's often a very awful place. So they try to withdraw from it. That's cool. I respect that. There are others, and I think our church is one of those. Do you know what the motto for the ELCA is? What you call the tagline? God's work, our hands. We believe we should be involved in the world. Things like soup kitchens and voting and taking a role in society is important. So in short, we try to figure out where Jesus said no to things and follow him there, and where he said yes and follow him there. So let's keep going here. So on Confirmation Sunday, this is some of the words that we're going to be saying. Proclaim the word of God. Proclaim the good news of God in Christ, the word indeed, serving all people, following the example of Jesus, and so on. And that's some of what you're going to say on Confirmation Sunday. This is the big question that I will be asking you when you're standing at the altar. We're going to get to that part in a minute. You have made public profession of your faith. We'll have just said the Apostles' Creed together. Do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism? In other words, in baptism God said, I'm yours, will you be mine? How are you going to do that? To live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God, share the Lord's Supper, proclaim the good news of God, serve others, strive for justice. And I hope to hear all of you together in nice, strong, clear voices say, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. And we'll be practicing that later. Because if I hear, I'll make you do it over. We want to hear you. But it's not over. Because I'm going to ask everybody else in the room. Parents, godparents, siblings, friends, all the rest of your brothers and sisters.
Grandparents.
And grandparents. If they will support you. So this is a two-way street. You know, we got your back. And they will say, we do, and ask God to help and guide us. And they're going to help you keep those commitments. So on May 21st, here's how we roll. Show up at church by 9:30 and come here in the office. And either in here or in Meredith's room, are going to be these plastic zipper cases with a beautiful white robe inside with a little red stole that goes right over your shoulders. Come and get your robe on. I have your name on each one of those. Get ready. Somebody's going to bring you from here over to the church. And it's just easy to do it alphabetical order. So, Morgan, you're going to lead the parade. We'll go into the church, down the center aisle, turn left, and boom, 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 boom. You'll all sit right in the front row.
The grand finale.
Oh, you're pretty grand.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, so that's how we'll sit when we get started in the service. Then we're going to talk about God stories in a little bit. But at the moment, what I just, to make it easy, we'll go alphabetical. If you want to negotiate a different order for God stories, we can talk about that. We're going to come back to God stories. Anyway, the God stories happen pretty...
If you made our God stories like one big story somehow, somewhere.
You mean all of you together?
No. But like they were like interconnected.
That's asking a lot.
I'll write them all.
You'll write them all. Oh, I can see you making some money on this game. Anyway, after the God stories, a little bit later, not too much later in the service, you're going to be called up to the altar. So again, in the same order that you're sitting, you're going to walk to the either the side, Morgan, or along the front, and Landon and Kaylee will be on the right side. Spread out enough so that there's room for your parents, your godparents, your siblings to hang out with you. To bring a blessing. And I'll lead the service with probably Meredith's help from the altar. And then at one point in the service, we're going to go over that in a minute. We'll go over the service in a minute. I think I've got this hand up. Start here. So your God story, how many have never seen a God story at Mount Cross? That's what I thought.
I didn't pay
you're going to pay attention now. It's basically just a way of describing where are God's fingerprints on your life. For example, there are lots of ingredients that make you the person that you are. Your genetic makeup, some people call that your nature, the stuff that you were born with is part of who you are. There's also the way you were raised, the environment in which you live, your family, the culture you live in, that's part of what shapes you. But God is also a factor in that. God has a role, either directly through the things that you've experienced in worship or indirectly through God's people in your life. And so all that a God story is taking some time to talk about the God ingredient in your life some way. So... one of the ways I describe that is, what have been some of the aha moments where, oh, I think I recognize where God was the here or there, so on. Everybody take one of those and pass it around. So turn to the. There's one. Turn to the God story page. It's kind of greenish. God story is you telling others how your life story and God's story have met, or telling how your life is different, or has been influenced, or has been guided, or has been changed because of God. Or God story is you telling others. About the people God has used as gloves to touch your life. So there's no, you have to do it this way about it. This set of questions is only to get your creative juices flowing. And if you'd like to see one or two of them, I don't have last year's or even the year before's videos. I don't know what happened to them, but I have from 2 years ago. If you want to hear one or both of them, are you familiar enough with God stories that we can skip them?
Let's do it.
Yeah.
Do one. Which one do you want to do?
Julia.
Yeah.
Okay.
Let's skip Brandon.
I was born into God's presence in March of 30th, 2000, at Trinity
One idea. Don't feel you have to model that. Some people just build theirs on this list, and that's fine. Some
add a prayer, and they do a literary analysis. That's
fun. It's time to go to small groups. Feel free to do a prayer at the end, or not. Some do, some don't. Don't feel obligated to do any particular style. If you've got questions about it, feel free to ask along the way. You've got about a month. This is what, well, not quite a month, till May 21st. So almost a month. If you want to, the Wednesday before Confirmation Day, you can practice in the church. Go in, step up in the pulpit, I'll turn the sound system on. Because we get in there and out before the bells start rehearsing. If you want that, if that helps you, feel comfortable, that's cool. But that's not a requirement. So any questions about God's stories?
Can they be funny?
I wouldn't use the word funny.
Entertaining.
I would sort of expect nothing less.
Yeah.
Once upon a time, there was more. And then, I got baptized.
Play to your strengths, make yourself comfortable, and whatever that means in front of people. I mean, that's not always easy for people to be in front of people. How many of you have been in speech tournaments? Okay, so this won't be...
Third grade.
Okay, well, so you know a little bit what that's like.
I got one.
I memorized the poem, guys.
Okay.
So. When's my next one? My next one is in May.
So, before we get to that... So on the handout, just a reminder of some of the things. When you've got your robe on, we're going into the church. You'll go up and do your God stories. You'll sit down. You'll come up to the altar for the confirmation service, which is on the back of the white page. It says affirmation of baptism. And as you look that over, by the way, I sent an email home to all your parents. They're going to be looking for this when you get home tonight. So let them see it too. But the most important part, if you ask me, is about two-thirds of the way down. It's that section I already mentioned. You have made public profession of your faith. You intend to continue, and so on and so on. If so, answer together. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me. And I want to hear you say that right now.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
We're getting there, but I probably would have meant to do it over if that was all I got.
Wait, where is it?
It's
at the bottom?
Not quite to the bottom.
Okay.
And you'll have a copy, but you shouldn't need a copy of the program to be able to remember that many words. So I'll roll into that line again. If so, answer together. I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
If it comes out like that, I'll be so proud. So after that, after that moment, you're going to kneel at the railing. Your families will be invited to lay their hands on you. I'm going to come and put my hands on your head, say a prayer, which is, Father in heaven, for Jesus' sake, stir up in blank the gift of your Holy Spirit, and so on. And I'll do that for each of you all the way around the altar. After that, the service is pretty well done, and we'll stand, share the peace, and you guys will eventually work your way back with your families to your seats. Not quite yet. So that's where we turn back to the orange page here. After confirmation service, then we'll have communion. And then we will, when the service is over, we go straight to the patio. We line up behind the cake. No. Listen.
And take a picture.
We line up behind the cake and have our picture as a group. Then we go back into the church. We're still in our robes. We go back into the church.
And then we take off the robes.
We don't take off the robes yet. We have our robes on. Where you stand up by the cross and Meredith and me, we got a picture of the three of us. We got away a picture of just you alone. Bless you. Then when you... Bless you. When your pictures have been taken, you may go back into the office...
Then you take your robe off and hang it up and put it back in the zipper piece.
Then you can have cake. Then you take a picture with your robes off, and then you have cake. That's up to your parents and stuff. I don't want to see anybody eating cake in their robe. Question?
Okay, so confirmation day is the same day as my showcase.
Oh.
And my show starts at 1.
No problem.
So,
when do you have to be there?
As soon as possible.
Okay.
Because call time's usually like 10, but I can be late.
Okay.
But I'm gonna need time to like warm up and put on makeup, costume, all that. So if we could like do my pictures first or something.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We'll get you out first.
Okay.
Make a note. That part doesn't take long. And unless one of you gets really windy and does a 45-minute God story, you're the sermon.
How long is it supposed to be?
It's supposed to be whatever you're comfortable with.
So like...
The one from Julia was longer than average.
Okay.
But if you look at them, it's like 2 minutes. I think in older versions of this... this guide for writing them, it was like, it does still say that. Write it out in story form at least 2 pages. Well, take the time you need to tell what you need to tell. And like I said, feel free to talk to me about it over dinner during some of these weeks, or Meredith is a good source of help. Your parents will help you. Madeline's the only one that's got sisters she can ask to help, because all the rest of you are the first ones in your family.
Oh, yes.
Yay.
So, lucky you. So, if you learn any jewels of wisdom, you can share them with your classmates.
He had friends going to that youth group, so he just went with them.
Yeah. So, anyway, ask other kids from other confirmation classes that have gone before if you want to. So, anyway, there's the rule. That's that.
You forgot what you
said. I skipped over on the first page. Number three, what changes with confirmation? With God, nothing. God loved you since before the world began. God isn't changing God's mind about you because of your confirmation one bit. I'm thinking God likes that you're going to do this, but it doesn't make God love you more. In the eyes of this church, something does change. You become adult members of this congregation, which means you can now vote at our congregational meetings and be on church council as a voting member. You're an adult member of the congregation, full voting member. The only time your vote would not be allowed is if we were going to buy or sell property, I think, because the voting members have to be probably 18 at that point.
So, like, we can vote on church services, like times on church services. Stuff like
exactly,
that.
Yeah. If we have an annual meeting next January and we're going to decide to combine the two services into one at 7:30 in the morning, you can vote on that.
I'm not going to vote on that.
I'm just making that up.
Nine, at the
and,
least.
And so anyway, that's the one thing that's changed. And therefore, with great power comes great responsibility. That's why I mentioned the thing about stewardship. Turn to the green page, please. This is what we call the time and talent report. You may have seen these before. This we give out to adults every year, or most every year, to ask them how are they going to say thank you to church and community through their serving in different ways. From everything from helping with painting and landscaping and electrical and plumbing to teaching Sunday school or Bible school or being an assisting minister or a communion assistant. And I have taken this standard sheet and I have put some stars next to the ones that are more likely going to be of interest to
so we make the middle schoolers
high school.
Do all the dirty work with like the acolyte and PowerPoint?
Well, by the way, speaking of acolyting, you're still on the schedule till October. Till we can try. So you're going to be on the schedule till October. When we get the new confirmation class started in the fall and get those new sixth graders trained, you'll be relieved. You won't find your name on the
We'll be relieved if you do. But can we do it anyway?
If you'd like to continue to be an acolyte, check it on. For example, you probably are not likely, unless there's something about you I don't know, who are going to want to be on the endowment committee or serve on the audit committee. Probably not yet. Unless
what does that do?
The audit committee makes sure that we have accounted for all the money we've received and spent it properly.
No, so,
However, you're...
That's like 4-hour meetings off in the morning.
But down on the left column, you might want to be part of the church decorating teams that do put up the Christmas tree. Or you might be like a Wyatt Phipps who's killer with the video camera. You know, if he goes off to college, we're going to need somebody
to do
that.
I'm still waiting on
the
youth praise band.
On what?
The youth praise band.
You have the youth praise band?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, talk to Devin about that. I'm not your guy for the praise band.
Yeah.
All those things under worship, greeter, usher, reader. And you can still check acolyte.
So what's the AB?
Well, yeah, that part I didn't take out. It's often I adapted this form from where a husband and wife might use the same form. So the husband might be A and the wife B. I didn't take that out, so I should. So just check in the left column and I'll know. If you want to be in the bell choir, the sanctuary choir, play an instrument. We know some of you play. Flip it over. Again, there's Sunday school, Bible school, fun with faith helpers, tutors, church picnic helpers, and so on. So I'd like you to take some time with that with your parents and see if there's ways that you might want to give back to the church by saying thank you through your service. So there's that.
We have men's softball. My dad played.
I played too for a while.
My dad played for...
Where?
Men's softball.
When?
Remember that? I remember that.
I think he was playing well after I stopped. But I played on a team that we used to call Just One. Not W-O-N, but O-N-E.
Mm-hmm.
Because we wanted to win Just One.
Did you?
It took a while. We went 73 games in a row without a win. Yeah, that was hard. 73 in a row, we lost.
That's
And there's 10 games per season, 3 seasons per year, so you can do the math how long it took us to get a victory.
That's like 3 years.
Sometimes I like to name my like intramural team name, like what with a question mark to make this person who's like orating the piece company. It's the Crushers versus what?
Okay, I'm going to give you a card and take a pencil. What I need on the card as the first thing is your first, middle, and last names for your confirmation certificate.
Okay.
And then write legibly.
I just took measurements for my 8th grade graduate room.
Oh, you did?
Do I have to put my full
yes,
name?
Yes, that you do. Why?
This is a formal moment in that regard. And when you ask...
Wait, what?
First name? Landon.
When you have finished, step over into the doorway and I will measure you.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. We need to know how tall you are.
Yep, that's why you're coming over here to see me.
We're going to. I know how tall
I am. No, we probably shouldn't take off our shoes because we'll have shoes on.
Right, and they may not measure the same as the ones that we're getting for.
I took my measurements today. Do I need to?
Step away from the door.
Do you have shoes on?
Yeah. 5 foot.
You're 2 feet tall.
70 inches and a half, so I love that. 1, 2, 3, 4. 5'10".
You're not 5'8". Are you kidding me?
Okay.
You are not 5'8".
You're 5'4", huh?
You're not 5'8".
Watch.
Oops. Yeah, you're probably 5'8".
See? I see. 5'6".
I thought it was 5'7".
Okay. All right.
5'6". A little bit.
Dad's 5'10".
My mom only named me that because she feel bad that she didn't name anyone after my dad's side.
Is that okay?
Is this a laser?
Wait, we have the same names are after like her side.
Oh. You want to chase it? I've got everybody's cards back.
No, nah, dogs don't. Only cats.
I
tried it on my dog.
My dog is very strange.
Your dog's kind of
okay.
He
feels
like a cat.
So, that's about a few minutes before we go back over.
She has 6 autonomous roles in an hour.
What?
Questions about... Oh, we should all look at the camera and say hi, Kaylee.
Hi, Kaylee.
As soon as Landon gets his mug out of the camera. Hi, Kaylee. Because I'm filming this for her, and she wasn't able to be here.
Is it live stream?
Live stream.
No, I have to put it on YouTube.
Instagram.
So if you want to review what we did tonight, you can check in on my YouTube channel later.
You have a YouTube channel?
That's where I put all my Bible studies. It's a bunch of church stuff mostly.
I'll subscribe.
Oh, I'd love that. I'll pay you to do that. There's even, I think, videos of my vacation to Yellowstone or something. So. Anyway, questions about Confirmation Day? Any of the stuff we've talked about? God stories. Speechless.
Believe me, we're
going to
speech.
Oh, we won't be speechless.
We're
going to
be speechless for long.
Okay. Yeah, they take that one. Should we take those home? Your parents will be looking for them.
Oh, yeah.
Is that a fidget?
This is...
Questions about the God stories at all?
It's like it's the best
one.
Hmm?
I don't know.
It's those little things, you just like, I don't get it. Like, you just spin it?
Yeah.
Like, that's all it does? Yeah.
Yeah, they're the best.
What if you go
you
like
can
this?
Balance
you
it
know,
on
you
the
know,
August.
Let me try.
Try to balance it on
I'll
your forehead.
I'll show you how to do
on
it.
On your nose.
This is how you do it.
My nose is too pointy.
That might be good.
Yeah, that's good. You can feel the gyro, it's so cool.
Mm-hmm. Well, you ever done that with a bicycle wheel?
Yeah, I have. In math. It's so cool.
Oh, yeah. Take the front wheel off your bike sometime. Hold it at the axles and have somebody spin it really
it feels
fast.
Like you're, like,
try to turn it. You really feel it. I know. No, it's a smaller scale. You get a nice 27-inch wheel going, you know you've got a gyroscope.
Oh, I've been ready. Pull it back and we can make it go really fast.
Don't let it, like, fly out of your hands.
Can't you, like, take the weight out?
Set, go. No, it's not that fast.
Cover my teeth in case it went flying over here. Okay, back to the subject.
I got stuck in my hair once. That was not good.
What happened?
Got stuck in my hair.
Oh. So we're good?
Yeah.
Anything outside of confirmation you want to ask about? Ask me anything.
It just seems like a big decision.
You got to think about
what. Well, let me just say this.
It sounds like I'm guaranteeing something in
November.
And then
it's
something
I'm not. You are not guaranteeing. Every pastor would hope that at the moment you're standing there at the altar, this golden beam from heaven shines down on you. And it's the most spiritual life, most spiritual moment in your life, and it charges you up for the rest of your future. And if that happens, I will be so grateful, but I will not expect it. And I'll use myself as an example. I went through confirmation like you did a little bit later. In my church, it was the start of ninth grade instead of the end of eighth grade. Did the whole white robe thing and didn't feel any different. In fact, I shouldn't be admitting this, but when I was in ninth grade, in end of eighth grade, start of ninth grade, my mom and I made a deal. She said, if you finish confirmation, I won't make you go to church anymore. I said, cool. So I bailed for about a year. I don't suppose I didn't ever go, but it was, I felt like that, because church just wasn't cool. So one day, the next year, it was longer than that, it was 11th grade, my mom left the church newsletter where I could see it, and there was an article about a youth group trip to San Francisco for a hunger conference. I thought, that sounds fun. Not because it was spiritual, but because San Francisco, it just sounded like fun. So I went, and I got hooked back in. And so that was when I was in 11th grade. It was finally when I was teaching high school Sunday school as a college student that I have to say I had one of those big ahas, where a whole bunch of the stuff that my pastors were teaching me in confirmation kind of went, oh, that's what they were talking about. So it's a lifelong process. This is the one time, well, I shouldn't say that. The same service that we're using for you on May 21st, we use from time to time to remind all of us of what our job is as baptized people of God. So you will see this service return, and every time we receive new members in the church, in fact, just 3 weeks after we use it for you, we'll use it again for adults, other adults who are joining the church. So it's something that you continue to recommit to. It's not a once-in-a-lifetime, one sign, you're done. And don't be afraid of doubts or questions or wonderings about what you've gotten yourself into. That's totally part of the landscape. There are some people who have the impression that, I don't know what to do with it, but they got to get by the guy with the funny thing in his collar, you know what I'm saying? That you gotta, I'm the gatekeeper, okay? And I let in the people to the church who have proven they believe the right stuff. That ain't the way it works. God already decided you're in. That's just what God does. You're in. And once in the kingdom, you're inside the gate, all right? You're inside the walls of the castle, shall we say. What is left for us to do is explore. Ask questions. Look behind every door, under every rock. Try to figure things out. And I'm sure that as we do that, God sometimes goes, that was good. They figured that one out. I'm impressed. Other times God goes, they're so cold, they don't even know what they're doing. And that's all part of it. But you don't have to do anything to get inside the castle, if you will. You're there. And God hopes that you live like children of the king. Everybody in the world was died for by Jesus. Everybody doesn't know it, and certainly everybody doesn't live like it. You know that. You've watched TV and so on. But those of us who appreciate that we're inside, try to spread that as best we can. So. All right. We good? Let me finish with a prayer. Lord Jesus, all of us are continuous works in progress. I thank you for the parents of these young adults who kept their promise on the day they were baptized and have seen to it that they have continued their life connected to the church and to your people and to your word and your sacrament and your life. I pray that on the day of their confirmation, certainly I hope they are filled with a sense of your Spirit's presence, but I hope that this day is just the first of many days where they are feeling that they are committed to you and this your people and whatever place they might find themselves. Bless them, bless all of their family who may be coming from any distance, that they be brought safely, so that the day will be a celebration of your love for us and your life in us, in Christ. Amen. All right, we're going to go back over and join the rest of them for
Please.
Closing.
Another prayer.